stuck around. We had a bit of a local break. Let me now kind of give a project overview over the QSolid project where we are standing. This project overview has multiple audiences, and some audiences will really like the beginning because you're new to the project, for example. Some audiences will be more focused on the end with recent updates. So we have made this a public talk for everybody at the University of Cologne, both online and in person. So there are people who wanted to join. I think I see one person who have never seen anything of QSolid before and want to get an introduction. Also, we have quite a few new team members. And if you're an experienced team member, you will see a few things in the presentation that you have seen before, for example, at the Laser Fair in Munich or at the kickoff. Who of you has not been at the Laser Fair in Munich and not at the kickoff? That is almost the whole room, so you will see new slides. Wonderful. So there's a few experienced QSoliders, and you will see a bit of update in the end. Also, we are recording this for our advisory board, and you will see who our advisory board actually is. So I gave you a general overview of the project. I will quote a few project highlights, and then talk a little bit about the context, what has been going on around us, and where I, as a coordinator, who where we are standing.
So our project is set up to run 5 years. It has started on January 1st this year. You see that there's a lot of people. I think at the peak of this event, there will be 100 QSoliders here from 25 project partners. And the idea is really to develop a complete quantum computing stack, which means that we are highly interdisciplinary, because for turning a physics device into a computer, you still need physicists, but you also need computer science. You need a lot of engineering of various kinds and so on. So the key objective is that when you look at quantum computing in the media, oftentimes you see various superlatives around the number of qubits in a system. But when you look more closely, in many platforms, including ours, the error rates are actually the limiting factor. So a high priority for us is low error rates. What we are building should be integrated into the supercomputing infrastructure at the Forschungszentrum Jülich, and it should clearly position Germany very well in quantum computing. Germany has done a lot of pioneering work in superconducting qubits. The first complete blueprint of a superconducting qubit chip came from KIT in 98. And the first adiabatic quantum computing processors were manufactured in Jena in the early 2000s. But then other areas have caught up in the move to applied science. But we are here to be in this arena. So as a high-level summary, the big priority, as I said, is really low error rates. We are building systems, first a 10-qubit system, then a 30-qubit system, and then a 30-qubit system enhanced with resonators. And I explain you why enhanced with resonators is actually truly exciting. We are building the complete hardware stack, and we're even looking a bit ahead. We have a couple of solutions that I will explain that for 30 qubits, you would probably not even really need. But for the next generation, you need them. For example, a cold control system is something that's definitely needed in the future. We test it here. But it also, we are developing a complete software stack. And you will see a bit about the different layers of software that are needed for this quantum computer. And because we are a publicly funded project, and even though we have a great industry participation, a lot of the funding, a lot of the activities in the public sector, the benchmarking, the checking of how good this actually is, we want to do very diligently, because we don't have to please our sales numbers or shareholders by making kind of exaggerated claims. We make components accessible in the sense that specifically a lot of our industry partners are making enabling technologies, and so people can use them. And it is a, as you will see, an all German project, even though there's a clear center of gravity around Jülich and in the Rhineland. So if we look at the partners, the Forschungszentrum is clearly the largest partner with about 2/3 of the budget, if budget is the unit in which you would like to count. You know, I'm always a bit hesitant to just qualify projects by budget, because if my research budget would be my source of pride, I would be a plasma physicist, an experimental one. At the Forschungszentrum Jülich, there is now a number of activities in different areas. And part of this, part of the presentation is to give you the big picture. I am standing outside the camera angle. Now, not anymore, is to also give you a little bit the structure behind the many partner presentations you see at this meeting. So we have an activity in PGI, which is the traditional solid state physics institute. Rami Barents is a central personality, because he will build, he's building the final system and he's in charge of the critical path. David DiVincenzo is looking at many theory aspects and is, you know, a true trailblazer of quantum computing. Tommaso Calarco, his institute is looking at many quantum control aspects, and he's of course also an engine of the whole quantum computing community. That's me. Christel Michielsen at the Supercomputing Center was very early in the game of actually making quantum computers accessible. And Stefan van Waasen and his institute of the ZAR2, that's an electrical engineering institute. And I think they started as an instrumentation provider, but now are very research intensive. So here in the Grünberg Institute, we have materials and systems. Stefan van Waasen is looking at control electronics, and Christel is looking at systems evaluation. If you look at more hardware partners, we have hardware partners in Baden-Württemberg, in Karlsruhe, and Stuttgart. They are mostly looking at advanced fabrication. So basically, at fabrication out beyond the critical path, because to reach our goals, we really, really need to improve device quality, which we can either do by making the known technologies incrementally better, or by finding something completely revolutionary, and they're in charge of the revolutionary aspects. We have hardware partners in Thuringia, looking at aspects of applied superconductivity and packaging. The PTB, a metrology institute, a National Metrology Institute in Niedersachsen, is active in the initialization system, and you will see a little bit later why metrology, the science of precise measurements, is truly crucial for an undertaking like us. And LPKF, Rosenberger, and Supracon are all looking at wiring. Rosenberger makes connectors. I own one on my electric bike. We have a couple of engineering partners. Clearly here, the transition is a bit gradual. We have a team that is centered in Saxony and then is also partnering with Atmos, who are building a cold control system, and Zurich Instruments, who are, despite their name, now actually have an outpost in Bavaria. They're now a Bavarian company, are looking at the initial warm room temperature control system. Now, for modeling and theory, we have we are very academic heavy. You see, so far we had mostly had research and technology organizations and companies, but here our hosts in Cologne and also at Heinrich Heine Universität, and I think in Cologne, it's not everybody knows that this town is relatively close by where they are. But also our partners in Baden-Württemberg are active in this area. But to make sure that what is being developed is can be integrated into the design flow, IQM has a theory task that is related to developing modeling software. If we are looking at firmware and software, there's a whole software stack. I'll explain you a little bit more. We have a team with Atos, with a company called Science and Computing, which is a spin-off of the University of Tübingen. That's my understanding of this company. I haven't visited you yet. And HQS, and here Partech and Parity QC. So they make sure that what we are building is really seamlessly integrated into high-performance computing, that we don't have a clunky cloud interface, but really good integration. HQS is helping with application benchmarks, and Cruise, which is based in the Saarland, is looking at firmware that is making sure that the quality of gates is high and stays there. Now, I've already mentioned, so is a bit of a structured overview of the partners. As I've mentioned, we have appointed an advisory board, and this is who they are. So Astrid Lamprecht is a vice president in charge of this area of the Forschungszentrum Jülich, and she is a theoretical quantum optician by background. And you know, as she's there because she's an executive of the largest partner, because maybe I should say this before, what we really want from this advisory board is friendly high-level feedback. So friendly in the sense that they are on our side, but they have a lot of experience, which by occasionally interacting for the project, so that we are not going in the wrong direction in our day-by-day, day-to-day. And this is also helping us to mitigate risks because they bring some experience in there, which otherwise we wouldn't have. Michael Bolle, who is chairman of the board of the Carl Zeiss Stiftung, which is his present role, and we should always introduce people by their present role, but in his case, we should also mention his past role. He used to be the chief technology officer of Bosch. So he is clearly looking at industry aspects and industrialization aspects of our consortium. Daniel Estev, who will also lecture tomorrow, is one of the pioneers of experiments of superconducting quantum circuits. He's from Saclay. Mark Weber is also on the leadership level of KIT. I don't quite understand KIT's org chart, but his job title sounds impressive. And he's an electrical engineer who has a lot of experience in instrumentation for projects that are even larger than we, namely high energy physics project. So with him, I'm looking forward to also hear about how to coordinate these things. Hans Hilgenkamp from the University of Twente is, these people are roughly ordered. So this is Daniel Steff, this is Mark Weber, this is Hans Hilgenkamp, is a kind of a community leader in the area of applied superconductivity, which is a very well structured and active community, but sometimes because they have their own conferences, people from neighboring communities don't know them so well, but they have actually amazing achievements. So he will connect us to this community. Saro Fazio is a theoretical physicist who has done a lot of basic research around superconducting quantum circuits. And he's a program director at the International Center of Theoretical Physics in Trieste, in Italy. And he'll be here, I think, starting tomorrow. So some of them will be here. We have appointed this board over the last couple of months. These are people who are booked a year out. And they will kind of interact with everybody. And then in a separate telco, they will give us feedback on how they think we are doing and how this influences things. So work packages. I have somehow missed one slide, but I'll just say what's in there. So this is a long list of work packages, but there's some structure to it in the sense that we are starting from, in work package one, from the critical path. So that is our best guess on how to reach our goals, where we are making rather conservative choices of technology because we know that we can incrementally engineer them, and it's led by Rami Barents. Then we have element evolution. This is where we are looking at basic quantum elements on the chip, which could be a shortcut to reaching our goals a lot better or a lot more quickly, more coherent materials, for example, but where we are not sure whether they will work at all. So there is a higher risk, but if they're working well, they will make it into the critical path. Scaling technology looks at further superconducting elements, and they're also shouldering some of the fabrication right now, that are needed to go around the qubits. So qubits are also a little bit in there, but they go around the qubits and that are still superconducting. The QPU environment is then getting gradually more into the area of engineering, and hardware integration is looking at the electronic system, the classical electronic system that is running the computer. So then you see by the color gradient, because classical electronics already has a strong software component. For example, with Zurich Instruments, I'm never sure whether they are mostly a software or mostly a hardware company. And the answer is probably yes. So then there's hardware modeling and theory, connected to the hardware stack for external access. And we should appreciate that going from critical path to hardware stack for external access is the journey of going from an experiment to a computer, because the hardware stack is supposed to run continuously with people making sure that it runs all the time with external users, that's what it takes to run this. And then the middle and firmware stack and control, work package 8, is looking at calibration, at bring up, at taking the good hardware and getting maximum performance out of it and keeping it there. And specifically keeping it there is kind of also a new task for the community. Benchmark and co-design is looking at, with the layout we have, what can we actually achieve in the end in terms of application? High performance computing integration is then the connection to the supercomputing system. This is, okay, I should have done this before. This is color coded where partners are. And as I already mentioned, Jülich has a lot of dots here. Now, one thing that I wanted to say, which I seem to have suppressed this slide accidentally, is that a lot of these work packages, you know, these work packages are the size of a typical BMBF project actually. So, and you are wondering why are there not separate BMBF projects? And in some areas there are separate projects. But the key is of course that here, everything that's developed, for example, a new qubit, should in the end still be tested along the critical path. Oftentimes people develop something, but then it's not compatible with the mainstream development. And here everything enters the critical path. Let's look at a few technical aspects. You know, the simple question, which it took me 20 minutes to get to, is what is our qubit? So it's superconducting qubits made from Joseph junctions. This is a picture from 2014, taken at UC Santa Barbara, but it's quite current. And you know, for those people not in the field, there's a few interesting things to observe. First of all, this picture is in color. That means it's not an electron microscope picture. It's done under an optical microscope. So the structures on here are not super small. They are kind of on a micron scale. And here you see crosses. These are these qubits. And here you see lines in and out. They are chips. They are, as I mentioned, not so small. And one thing that's actually interesting is that usually we learn that non-trivial quantum behavior, non-classical behavior, happens on the microscopic scale of matter, that you need individual elementary particles. And this is often true, but here is the exception, because superconductivity itself is a macroscopic quantum state. Here we are working with collective electromagnetic degrees of freedom. And Tony Leggett taught us in the early 80s why those can still be quantum. There's an interesting thing on the timeline. When we talk about what is the origin of quantum computing, we typically quote a talk by Feynman in the early 80s. And if you then check, Tony Leggett proposed what we now call the superconducting flux qubit half a year before Feynman. Now, he didn't call it qubit. He envisaged this as a device for testing quantum mechanics on a macroscopic scale. Now, how macroscopic this really is a semi-philosophical topic. We can discuss this at dinner tonight. But what you see is our qubits are essentially electrical circuits And the details of what is going on in the Joseph junctions will be mentioned by Daniel Estève in the lecture tomorrow. What we are aiming for is this caterpillar or RNA layout of a double strand of qubits. Why are we doing this? So the goals that we were given and that we aim to achieve is to have a midterm device. And after 2.5 years, so we have about 20 months to go, that has 10 qubits and a 1% error for 2-qubit gate, which is consistently across the chip, which is already quite demanding. And then in final, we need to divide this error by 2 and make it work on a larger device for the worst pair of qubits. And one reason why this is compatible with making this double strand is that if you're making this, so these are qubits, the gray lines here are coupling elements, and these wiggly lines are measuring elements, and then the purple lines are control lines. Here, relatively few wires cross. And it turns out, if you want to make making crossings that work, it's typically very difficult and it's typically costly on the error budget. So this is a way to reach low error on the compromise of having a bit of a restricted layout. This is what we call the moonshot device. So here you see again the double strand. Blue crosses are qubits, purple things are tunable couplers. And these resonators are continuous quantum mechanical degrees of freedom, where we can use more than 2 states. And this way we can, in principle, address a state space dimension that can be up to 2^100, which would be where otherwise you would need 100 qubits. But these are not qubits, so we have to see how to make best use of them. Let me actually go to this right now, because again, what I just said, I have not quite memorized all my slides. The whole point of making the device and the structure is that this is quite inconvenient for application and software developers. In the sense that if you want to run an algorithm, you would prefer to have a square, or even better, a cube, a three-dimensional thing, because then the medium distance between 2 qubits is relatively low and you can make operations between qubits rather compactly. Whereas here, you have to go along the double strand. But it's hard to implement this in software, but making hardware with the low error we want is even harder. So we have a bit of a software challenge. And the other challenge is to make good use of these resonators. Here is again the decoherence and error mechanisms. This is a plot that's a bit outdated that shows you that the coherence time, the time over which we keep coherence, over which as we've tomorrow, we still have quantum interference, has grown in the community by several orders of magnitude. If we continue this curve, it would get a lot flatter. And these are measurements of typically coherence timescales. This is from Princeton University. This is close to the world record. And we really, for making our project goals, we really need to add an order of magnitude here. And this is one reason why we focus so much on coherence. Adding this order of magnitude requires very diligent materials research. You could say this differently. We all have seen the famous result of Google. Yes, dear Zoom audience, I am a walker and I try to constrain myself, but to stay in the screen. The Google quantum beyond classical result, I think beyond classical performance is the good modern word for quantum supremacy, what used to be called quantum supremacy, was executing a synthetic benchmark. So a test that is meant to be a test that makes the quantum computer look good. And that is completely okay. The Wright brothers' first flight and the first Sputnik mission were both synthetic benchmarks. Nobody in the history of space flight was really having as a disruptive application goal to have something fly around the order and beep to annoy the Americans. However, it was a stepping stone. But if you want to go to realistic benchmarks, on the same devices, you're using a lot fewer qubits. because those benchmarks are not so friendly to the hardware. And this is the reason why we need to tackle errors. And here I told you how we do this. So how do we approach this as a project? The most important thing is to make good qubits. And here we are affording redundancy, as you can see by this logo. We are starting with established qubits made out of aluminum in a process that already exists at Jena and that they are ramping up right now. And that will hopefully in the end of the project result into a foundry. Foundry means that people who want to experiment with qubits but have no capability of making their own, they send a drawing to Jena and they get back a chip. PGI 13 is building up a source of scalable high fidelity qubits that can really go to large scale. And at some point after the midterm, this should take over fabrications. And KIT, collaborating with Stuttgart and the PGIs 3 and 9, they're looking at deeper materials diagnostics. You've seen at the talk from Stuttgart, what are the things that you can measure to really find issues and challenges in your materials. And also, it's important to have this redundancy because it's important that we do a lot of testing and that, you know, if things don't get delivered in Jülich and the Saale floods IPHT, which is unlikely there on a hill, but that we can still fabricate somewhere because that is the most crucial thing we do. Let's look a little bit about how we can make, how we can reduce errors. So if you're looking at a plot like this, at 1 nanosecond, I was actually around when that happened. It was extremely clear what experimental compromises were limiting this. This experiment from Nakamura from the late 90s was extremely heroic. And here, people could make big disruptive inventions to improve coherence. Up there, you have eliminated all the obvious errors. So I like to quote Sherlock Holmes novels, very improbable and unlikely errors are now limiting performance. You have heard in the morning that, for example, it's now ionizing radiation from, among other things, cosmic rays are performance limiting. So putting an experiment deep underground improves your error rate. So we have come a long way. And this is why we need the mindset of metrology, the mindset of people who make atomic clocks and related things for a living to work with extremely, to reach these extremely low error rates. Also, we should not forget that next to noise and decoherence, there can be unitary errors. Unitary error means you, for example, drive your qubit with a resonance, but you're not quite hitting the resonance frequency. Or you have a degree of freedom, a resonance in your system that has nothing to do with your qubits, but that is still in the dangerous frequency region. And the way how we hope to do this, and I'm really optimistic. I think we've actually this is this morning's version of the slides, but let's see. I can work with those, don't worry. Is that there will be a workshop, I think in October at IQM. Is anybody still here who can confirm this? About closing the modeling loop. Because on the one hand, we, for example, have groups at PGI 2, and also Konstanz, as we have seen before, who are bottom-up modeling circuits, who are predicting how they should perform. And IQM's tool, KQ Circuits, hopefully gives them experimentally testable predictions. But then, for example, with the diagnostics that's built in our firmware, which is coming from Cruise, will tell us what is actually a good model that describes the hardware. So on the left is what we want to build, on the right is what we do build. And to make progress, the hope is that we can actually close the loop, that we can compare the left error and the right error and narrow down the differences. That brings me to firmware. As I've already mentioned, we need the mindset of metrology. We need to kind of work at high precision limits. And in the best devices, it's typically even hard to know what is limiting you? Because if it's your best device, you have clearly avoided any kind of, you have avoided the errors, you know, most likely. And sometimes we have an idea, for example, in cosmic rays. But the idea of the firmware that is coming from Cruise, and I should say that Cruise is an associate partner of our project and will hopefully be a full partner soon, pending important administrative aspects, is that when we design the pulse shapes that control the system, we are not only getting good pulses, optimal pulses that drive a universal gate set, as already mentioned by Jürgen Stockburger also this morning, but that we test those, that we calibrate the system model-free. So we are basically looking at how well are we doing, how do we have to change the pulses to even increase the performance, and then pipe out data that slowly builds a digital twin that then gives us the best model that describes our hardware. And that gives us the model on the right. And this is important because A, that will allow us to get the best out of our hardware. And B, it's a known weakness of systems that are currently online that they have one calibration run in the day. And for an hour afterwards, they have really low error rates and then it's deteriorating. And one goal of this firmware is to make sure we can recalibrate often because we can do it in a smart way. And we can do it quickly to have good performance over the whole day. Another highlight, and these highlights were basically chosen also for being easy to communicate. So if you are, as a partner, not in the highlight, it doesn't mean that I think your work isn't the highlight, but it's difficult for me to explain. Wiring strategy. Whenever we are seeing pictures of quantum computers, we are seeing these fabulous chandeliers, that's English for Kronleuchter, of cryostat inserts. And their structure is dictated by temperature drops from top to bottom, cooling systems in the middle and in the walls, and everything is shiny to reflect thermal radiation. And then we have these enormous trees of wires, and you need more than one per qubit. And they have to have a minimum distance because they are hand inserted and you actually need to have a wrench to tighten them. That does not sound like scalable computer technology, does it? So we could probably go with this technology until 30 qubits, but we want to look at the future. So we are starting with improving the connectors, but then our partners at Supracon, LPKF and Rosenberger are jointly developing a flex cable strategy where you have cables with multiple wires in them, a connector in the bottom that at least bundle a lot of these wires into a very compact package and make this much easier to use also as a commercial project. I have learned at some point as a theorist that you want wires that work at the right frequency, that work at low temperatures and that are non-magnetic. And if you want to order something, one of these things doesn't exist. I think typically they are magnetic. But then we will want to go one step further and see, can we actually avoid having all of these analog wires? These are coaxial cables. If you're old enough to remember analog television, that's the thing you connect to the antenna to. By bringing a control system to the cold part of the cryostat, and we have seen there are two approaches to this. One is based on classical superconducting electronics, which is nice because it's the same technology that's coming from CIS. And the other one, which is coming from a Dresden-centric team based on cold CMOS, that is also nice because CMOS is a lot more mature than superconducting electronics, and we will see what is working. For the room temperature electronics that's sitting outside, we are starting with a Zurich Instruments solution, but CEA2 is now working towards a customized setup. Further kind of important point and amplifiers. So when we want to read out our results, we are reading out a tiny, tiny quantum signal. And we want to have something that is high resolution, so it can reliably tell the qubit states apart, which means that it's near quantum limited, which means it's good enough that the Heisenberg uncertainty principle is something you start to feel. And this is typically by parametric amplifiers. Probably most people know what this is. If you don't know this, a child on a swing can, by waving her legs, get in motion even when the feet are not touching the floor. And that is parametric amplification. You are essentially changing the moment of inertia, or if you want, the mass of a pendulum. And if you do this with the right frequency, which is twice the eigenfrequency of the system, no, it's half the eigenfrequency of the system, excuse me, then you are getting in motion. And this, what we're building here, is a very advanced version of a child's swing. And we are starting with a very simple device from KIT. And my understanding, so Johan cannot make it today, but my understanding is everybody, so KIT has already sent a few of them to internal partners, and their design can now also be reproduced by others. It's a typical recipe where you cannot patent anything because these things are in principle known, but they are still hard to get right. And to my understanding, PTB has already taken their recipe, made a parametric amplifier, and it works. And this is important for getting a lot of people started. But then we go to traveling wave parametric amplifiers. The first generation is coming from IPHT. And then we want to have a high power version from PGI-13. And PTB is using those for making an initialization system, for making a system that makes sure we're starting in the right state. And a good way of this is measuring, because when you measure, you're projecting into the right state and then applying an operation to get from the state you have into the state you want. Software stack and benchmarks. So as I mentioned, there is absolutely no such thing as a pure hardware project. You know, I've shown you tons of hardware, but a pure hardware project doesn't exist. In fact, in technologies that are as banal as cars, right? Cars are simpler than quantum computers, we would think. We already see software bottlenecks. This is the reason why I'm not driving a specific German electric car, because when I wanted to buy one, they were making them, they were putting them on a parking lot because the operating system wasn't ready. And we have seen that already calibration software is really complex. And here we go to the next step. So we have seen cloud access to quantum computers often, which means you're sending them a script at some point gets executed. But cloud access to a Jupyter notebook is not the same as high-performance computing integration. For high-performance computing integration, you, for example, want to have a good scheduler. You want to have a system that uses your quantum computer and its classical companion in an optimal way. That, however, also allows for calibration cycles. And this is done by our HPC integration team. Then you want to use the hardware in a clever way, mitigate errors. This is what we are doing. But then in the end, you also want to do that you're doing the right thing. Düsseldorf is looking at fault tolerance, and our hosts in Cologne are looking at the moonshot and will tell us whether by some probably synthetic benchmark we can use beyond classical performance. So this is the software and theory team. And thus, this is basically a big networking opportunity. You know, we have people at this conference who probably otherwise would have never met. Let's take a random example, LPKF and David DiVincenzo, probably hardly at the same conferences. And that is good for inner project networking, but we are also not alone. There are a lot of projects in the same call. For example, QXARM, Munich SC, which are also projects on superconducting qubits. And somehow, by the way, how this program works, we are now competitors, but we are not really, because we are not competing against industry, against the Americans, or against the Kingdom of Bavaria. No. We are competing with decoherence. We are competing with the fact that nature, unfortunately, wants controlled quantum systems to become classical way too quickly. And this is, I think, where we should stay. Now, I have spent a surprisingly long time on this. And before this, I was really worried that I wouldn't have enough material. But that's fine, because these were the pretty slides, which I made at some point, and they looked ugly. And then I sent them to Euris, and they came back in the nice form you have seen. Where are we now? The project has been running for 9 months now. And I have often seen in projects that the first time is a bit of a death zone. And for us, that was also a risk. You know, we got the Zuwendungsbescheid in the Christmas break. Somehow German ministries and Projektträger have a fantastic passion for paper. So I think I got an email from Supracon from Jena that they picked up the mail between Christmas and New Year's, and the Zuwendungsbescheid, Santa brought a Zuwendungsbescheid. In English, that's the confirmation that you got funded. And then, of course, we needed to hire people. Some people could be moved. And we needed to create new structures, because we are a large consortium, and the way how these projects are typically set up at the VDI, at our Projektträger, at BMBF, is meant for smaller teams. So we needed to invent part of the management structure. And if you have feedback that we could do it better, I'm absolutely hearing it. I do not claim that we have invented the perfect solution. I do think we have invented a good workaround, or a good approximation of a good solution. Specifically, we have monthly steering board meetings that involve the work package leaders. And we have bi-weekly coordination group meetings between Euris, our management contractor, and a few internal people from the Forschungszentrum. If we're looking at a few highlights, I have stolen this from our intermediate report. I told you in the beginning that Rami's group, Rami has experience in building large quantum computing systems. He was one of the lead authors of the big Google paper, but he doesn't have equipment right now, and IPHT has experience, and I'm hoping I'm characterizing Gregor correctly, that they have never made a gate-based multi-qubit system, never operated this. But they are in close exchange to bring the processes together. And one thing which I like here, this is apparently an automated design. So this design of a chip was not made by humans. It was made by a machine, and it has led to good chips. And one thing they're, for example, looking at is to make sure that all devices on a big wafer work. One thing I found interesting as a theorist is when you say big wafer, what do you actually mean? Because in Jena, that's 4-inch, and in Sachsen, that's 12-inch, because 12-inch is the standard of the semiconductor industry. But if you need to test all of these devices, 12-inch has way too much stuff on it. In a way, for test runs, this seems to be a sweet spot. The second thing we are aiming at, and there will be a breakout session tomorrow, we have not promised to everybody, but we still try to make a really good 2-qubit gate, kind of around the turn of the year. Why are we doing this? It's because building a tiny and by global standards trivial prototype will help us to identify gaps. Because now we need to make a chip outside the Forschungszentrum. We need to operate it. We need to make an interface to the software stack. We need to run tests. We need to connect it to KIT's readout systems. And all of these components are simple, so we can concentrate on bringing them together and to make sure that the interfaces are working, and then we can build from this. So this is a bit of a gap analysis. Another highlight I've already mentioned is KIT has a recipe for simple parametric amplifiers. And we are considering to also commercialize them. I think here this doesn't work, but there's an idea that Supracon could actually commercialize them to help people getting a hand of these devices. Something I would like to mention from my own group is I've shown you the resonator enhanced architecture. And it turns out projects I'm in that have nothing to do with QSolid are now embracing this architecture to check what we can do with this. So my student Ricardo, who's in a European ETN project, is looking at, can we simulate the Hubbard-Holstein model effectively with the circuit? The Haber-Holstein model is a model for materials where the lattice vibrations and the electrons are interacting strongly. So it has the Haber model aspect. You have jumping, interacting, spinful electrons, but they're all coupling to phonons. And you can map these guys on qubits. You can map those on resonators. And then you have to deal with an ocean of details, which is Ricardo's PhD thesis. And it's interesting, you know, we kind of took him over to help QSolid, but our colleagues in his network are excited about this opportunity. And in a similar spirit, my student Yannick Weber is looking in the context of a Sonderforschungsbereich at the Ising-Dickey model. That's a model of a magnetic chain that is coupling to an optical mode. It combines magnetism with optical emission. And I think this is something we see that we are also shaping the community. Let's look a little bit about what's happening around us. So now it's less about physics. Well, I'm talking about politics most of the time anyway, but we are currently finishing an application for OpenSuperQ Plus. Remember, OpenSuperQ was a process that also a bit ignited quantum computing of superconductors in Germany. It's a European project, and we have now applied for the extension, and this brings together a lot of European centers. The Forschungszentrum is coordinator, which means in practice, I am coordinator. Yes, this is an interesting life. Interesting is a curse in Chinese. But I'm kind of, you know, I wouldn't do it if I wouldn't think I was effective. And Euris is actually the management partner. And if we appear a little bit sleep deprived, it's because we won the framework partnership, and now we need to write our first grant agreement, and the application deadline is next Tuesday. So if we look sleep deprived, that's why. It's interesting if you are thinking, oh, this is this gigantic European project. No. This European project, by the scale of our funding level, is severely underfunded. So if you are thinking, why am I not in this? You're not missing a lot of money. You're missing international relations. It's meant to be a three-stage rocket in the sense that OpenSuperQ 1.0 set the stage. And now in the next project, which we are currently applying for, we are working as a confederation of national projects in Europe in order to reach 100 qubits. And in level two, we want to build one machine that reaches 1,000 qubits. That will be interesting. This is where we are positioned in here. So this is the fleet of systems in OpenSuperQ Plus. Actually, our colleagues in Delft are embracing that they want to have 100 qubits in 3.5 years. And I am pretty confident that they will either get there, or the way how they fail will be extremely instructive. So they will at least get very close. Our colleagues from Munich and at Chalmers are also building additional integrated systems in this network. This is a boat on the Rhine. The boats are all nationally correct. We will at least make sure that the QSolid results can be accessed from the different computing partners with a unified look and feel. So if you have running something in Delft, but you rather would prefer to run it in Jülich, it has basically the same type of system. So this way, we are in this fleet of demonstrator projects. Another thing that happens around us is EinQuantum NRW, which I am only peripherally involved in, so David can correct me if I'm saying anything wrong. This is the state of Nordrhein-Westfalen. This is Jülich, and this is Paderborn, I believe. It's rather large for those people from the Saarland who always also think, how does Frank commute between Saarbrücken and Jülich? This distance is the same as Saarbrücken-Jülich. This project got traction in the beginning of the year. We had a special addendum in the Frankfurter Allgemeine Sonntagszeitung, and we brought together lots of people from Nordrhein-Westfalen, including industry. It's a large consortium, but you recognize partners like us, like like Düsseldorf, Uni Cologne, I'm sure is also somewhere. Athos is in there, but also there are a lot of other partners. For example, Paderborn, where they're doing photonic qubits, companies, there's Cologne. A lot of user companies like Covestro, that's a chemicals company. This is the name of the game. We need to industrialize things. And EIN, I think this abbreviation, wasn't it invented by Tobias's wife, actually?
Unless he's married to Dagmar Pruss, it wasn't.
Okay. So this is meant education, innovation, and networking. And in fact, the education aspect is extremely important. We all see that the market for quantum-aware colleagues is empty, and we need more of them. And plus, it's cool to study quantum physics anyway. So a clear goal is to have more teaching structures, develop study programs, education of various interest groups that includes continuing education, you know, Weiterbildung in German. How do I get people who are already working quantum ready, and also the creation of new positions in this area? It should also promote startups, develop business and industrialize further, get us in touch with the ecosystem. My understanding is that the funding that we have, so here it also networks, it attracts people. This is a picture of the kickoff meeting. I am not on there. This is used to be our industry minister. So one interesting aspect is that this was driven by the industry minister, not by the education minister. I think she was also involved, but it was really industry driven. The funding level apparently is an order of magnitude smaller than the Munich Quantum Valley, but we make up by our fantastic competence, so it will all be good.
Yeah, it's severely underfunded. Where did I hear this?
Yes. So this is the sum, but at least, you know, our big state is getting all its competencies together, and this is the steering board. Sorry, I didn't practice this kind of with a very nice narrative, but there is some interaction also with the ion trappers going on. So I think we can look forward for this because, in fact, the Projektträger, well, they can listen. When we 2 years ago thought that we really want to apply for this QSolid, we thought we make this the big Nordrhein-Westfalen hub. Now, that didn't work because that would have completely missed the call. But in essence, now Ein Quantum NRW and QSolid together certainly can form a fantastic unit. Now, other things we have done. Many of you were there. We were at the Laser Fair in Munich in late April, where we had a conference organized by our sponsors in a trade fair hall, which sounded really funny, but I thought it worked quite well. You know, there were talks in the corners and there was networking space. This was actually also the first time when lots of us met in person in this restaurant, and we got to know our sister project. This will probably go on. We will probably have this as an annual event. Another thing that I want to mention a little bit is as a coordinator, I have to do politics, and I try to take this seriously. We had a very interesting coordination meeting in late June at the conference center close to the Brandenburg Gate that probably had cost an amazing amount of rent. And I was in a podium discussion, and usually I'm not scared of this, but that was an unusual podium. It was organized by the ministry. What was interesting was to learn how our sponsors see our project, because we always wanted quantum computing to be politically important and to be relevant for Germany, and now we have it. So it was opened by a speech that really emphasized digital sovereignty, that was putting this into the context of things like supply chains and Ukraine and things like this. And you know, these are our sponsors. I'm not in the position to comment on this, but we should understand that digital sovereignty is truly important to them. So for example, when US consortium partners get a panic email from me if that one of your suppliers could suddenly be sold to the US, it's because the sponsors asked me the same question. This actually recently happened. It was also interesting that I was sharing the panel with people who are looking at a German digitization agenda a lot more broadly. for example, with the CTO of Deutsche Telekom. So we were discussing quantum technologies and quantum computing along digitization of schools, for example, and AI and things like this. So we are now on this political stage. This is how we are viewed. And this is just something we need to interact with. You know, we need to understand the mindset of our sponsors. They are very generous. So, yeah. What I also learned is that a famous science communicator from the 1990s has seen better days because he gave a talk that had nothing to do with the conference. Another thing that is going to happen, and if you have input, if you want me to communicate something there, let me know, is that on October 18th, this was the wrong button, there is a parliamentarischer Abend with state ministers, and I think we are covering actually all relevant states already, and with parliamentarians, where we explain people why funding needs to go on and why they should support us in the long term. QSolid will be represented there actually together with the Munich project, because we do not want to have any artificial separation between us, plus we don't have a lot of space. We try to put this into a framework of a Deutsche Quantengemeinschaft, which is something that was in the Strategiepapier of the Expertenrat already, which then we weren't allowed to found to start, but we want to make sure that the quantum community in Germany speaks with one voice. If you have input for this, if you want to know more, talk to me, but I wanted to share this with you. In the last 0 minutes, I have, I think these three slides are still a bit important. As mentioned, we are too big for the format with which we are funded, but the good thing is that we are funded. You know, the industry ministry first invented a whole new format, and they got out of the starting block a lot more slower. We have all been exposed to Großprojekte controlling. You have sent reports at unreasonably high frequency to Cora Meyer at Euris, who then turned them into real reports. And this is just something we have to deal with. A few comments about this. A, the people who are most scared about Großprojekte controlling are our Projektträger and the department in charge of us at the BMBF. Because the Großprojekte controlling is a completely independent unit. And as much as I find this annoying, I would say as a taxpayer, I want, if large figures are spent, that there is some oversight. The good thing is that we do not need to change anything about this because our reports are actually praised by the ministry, whereas other projects, you know, they need 3 months after submitting to get the project right. So Cora Meyer, who is running all of this, is on vacation right now, but I think we actually owe her and everybody at Euris applause to at least isolate the big mess from this. And we are also, you know, people envy us for our management team. We are also hiring a second integration engineer. This person should have been here for a while. The person we are recruiting is coming from a very high profile position in aerospace, and he is already quantum aware. And he will pester you with integration roadmaps and delivery deadlines once he's there. And I can tell you the name in private. I won't do so in public because he is in ungekündigter Stellung. So, otherwise, status of coordination, this is roughly my life, only I don't wear ties. We have a collaboration agreement, hallelujah. Thanks for everybody being constructive and thanks for keeping your lawyers under control. A lot of things we needed to set up, we needed to invent, because these type of BMBF projects are not meant to be this large. If you have feedback how we could do things better, please let us know. Because now it looks like we're entering in a steady state. Now we know what it takes and things are a bit in equilibrium. We want to be in the right equilibrium. And again, thanks to Euris, specifically Cora Meyer, Corinna Hahn, and Saskia Lennartz for keeping me close to mental health. I promised everybody, so this is the last slide. I'll skip the rest. I promise that I will visit all partners this year. It will not happen this year. By the way, this is my bike, which I take on all of these trips. But my visit to Thüringen, I think, was quite productive. And I'm doing this because I really want to understand what you're doing. Because in a project of this complexity, we will have to change the plan at some point. And the better I understand you, the easier changes of plan are.